wash in my eyes to see your majesty. So be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay.
Good evening, everyone. Welcome once again to the Word of God Speak. We thank everyone for joining us this evening. And as usual, let us open up with a word of prayer, because we know that our hour goes by pretty fast.
Heavenly Father, we just want to praise your name and give you thanks this evening for this and other opportunities to present your words, Lord. We know we're not worthy, so we ask that you clean us up, forgive us of our sins, so that your Holy Spirit can come in and teach us, Lord, and tell us what to say. May nothing be uttered but from your word. Be with our listeners, Lord, and bring the right people who need to hear a word from you tonight. Bless and keep each and every one of us, we pray. Thank you for all you've done. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. And tonight, we're going to be going into a topic that, you know, we touched on many of times, but We want to come from it with different angles, different approach, hoping by the grace of God to show how consistent the Bible is and how consistent the Bible is in explaining itself, and we don't need to go outside of the Bible to get an answer from what the Bible is trying to say to us. And all it takes is some time and some patience and some diligent
prayer.
Study. Pray, yeah, absolutely prayer and patience of going back and forth through the scriptures. Luke 17:26 says, And as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be also in the days of the Son of Man. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage, until the day that Noah entered into the ark, and the flood came and destroyed them all. Tonight we want to look into how was it in the days of Noah. However it was in those days, Jesus is telling us, is how we can know how it will be in the end, or how it will be in our day. So we want to take the time out to go and see what it was like in Noah's days, because however it was, that's how it will be in our time. So we're going to take the time to go through that. And one of the things I want to point out is we should be asking ourselves when we read something like this, why does Jesus point his people back to the beginning to describe the end of things? And I believe many reasons, but let us identify one of these reasons. And in John 14:29, the Bible says, in John 14:29, "And now I have told you before it come to pass, that when it is come to pass, ye might believe." So here we saying God is telling us that he's told us these things so that when these things do come to pass, we might believe. Might believe what? Might believe the gospel, might believe the word of God, that indeed of a truth. This is God's word. And then if you look at Isaiah chapter 41, verses 21 to 23, Isaiah 41, verses 21 to 23, we're trying to find out why is it Jesus points us back to the beginning to let us know what it will be like in the end. Isaiah 41, 21 to 23.
Could I just quickly give the number to listen, to dial to listen on your phone? For anyone who would like to listen on your phone, it's 213-493-0146. Welcome, listeners.
And Isaiah 21 says, 41, 21, produce your cause, saith the Lord. Bring forth your strong reason, saith the King of Jacob. Let them bring them forth and show us what shall happen. Let them show the former things, what they be, that we may consider them and know the latter end of them, or declare us things for to come. Show the things that are to come hereafter, that we may know that ye are gods. Yea, do good or do evil, that we may be dismayed and behold it together. Here you have God challenging the religions of that time. If you go and read the story, this chapter in Isaiah, where he's saying, if your God can declare the end of something from the beginning of something, then tell him to show himself and show me how he's God, that he can do that. And God is saying that this is how he's going to show that he's God, that he's going to show you the end from the beginning of something. And we'll continue on. God shows us the end of things from the beginning. In Isaiah 42, picking it up in Isaiah 42, verses 8 to 9, the Bible says, I am the Lord. That is my name, and my glory will I not give to another, neither my praise to graven images. Behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. So one of the characteristics of God is, before he does anything in the future, he tells you of it already in the past, and he gives you examples of it written down in his scriptures, that whatever's going to come in the future, this is how it's going to come first in the past. And continuing on with this to show you how consistent the Bible is. Now, look at Ecclesiastes chapter 1. Ecclesiastes chapter 1, verses 9 to 11. That the Bible is consistent with itself. The thing that hath been, it is that which shall be. And that which is done is that which shall be done. And there is no new thing under the sun. Is there anything whereof it may be said, see, this is new? It hath been already of old time, which was before us. There is no remembrance of former things, neither shall there be any remembrance of things that are to come with those that shall come after. Here, Solomon is admonishing us that we should remember the former things, because the former things actually is telling us what is going to come, what is happening now, and what will be in the future. Next. And then he says the people that come after the former things, they always forget the former things. Yeah. They never remember it, and you want to. This is one of the reasons why Satan hates the Old Testament.
Before you go on, I just wanted to add Amos 3:7, a very popular one. Amen. Surely the Lord God will do nothing, but he reveal his secret unto the his servants, the prophets.
And he reveals it through the scriptures.
Amen.
So one of the characteristics of the true God is, amen, that he can tell you the past, the present, and the future.
All in one. One story, all exactly. In one line.
And that's what I think, you know, the text is saying.
Amen. And look at this. This is why Satan hates the Old Testament. Mm-hmm. Because the Old Testament record is what tells us the former things, the past things. And if he knows he can get us to get rid of that, we will never understand what's coming in the future.
True.
So he gets rid of the Old Testament, tell people, only read the New Testament. You don't need the Old Testament. And by reading the New Testament, you don't know what's coming in the future. Because one of the characteristics of the Holy Spirit, Jesus says, howbeit when he has come, he will show you things to come. How is he going to show you something to come when you got rid of the majority of the Bible? He can't show you anything to come. So now continuing on. Now look at Ecclesiastes 3, 14 and 15. Now I hope you're beginning to see why Jesus says, as it was in the days of Noe, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. Because if you understand the former days of Noah, you'll understand the future days of us living in the last days. And God does this so that we might know that he is God. Right. When we see these things that it penned down, and the Bible says all these things were written for our ensamples. And samples mean type in 1 Corinthians 10:11. And then it says, Paul says we should admonish these things. And if you look up admonish means warning or rebuke. we should admonish these warnings that were written down because they're in samples. They are types of what's going to come in the last days. And God does this so that the man of God may fear before him, seeing how consistent he is that he told us these things already. Now, if you don't study the scriptures, you're not going to know. You're going to be in darkness, and you're going to be in, that's why Jesus says darkness is going to come upon those who don't study the word of God. And he says, walk in the light as I am in the light, because the word of God is our light.
You know, one thing I like to say about that, that's another way for Christ to say, like Malachi 3:6, I am the Lord thy God, I changed not.
Amen.
Because he's telling you clearly what happened in the days of Noah, that Jeremiah, the book of Jeremiah teaches you the heart of man is desperately wicked. You know, who can know it? So your heart is continuously wicked, and God's saying, I'm not going to change from what I did in the days of Noah to here. The only thing I left you back then was a promise that I won't do it by water. And it's not ironic that God comes in a baptism that you're baptized with is by water now and by fire. And God destroyed the earth by water and fire. Same way he destroys the old man, the old you publicly when you go into that watery grave. He does by water and fire, you know? And it's not an ironic thing that when he first destroyed the earth, it was by water. And now this time it's by fire. Amen. Again, just like the baptism, Amen. By water and fire.
Amen. Yes. And to back up what that is saying, Ecclesiastes 3:14-15 now says, I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it, nor anything taken from it. And God doeth it that men should fear before him. That which hath been is now. And that which is to be hath already been. And God requireth that which is past. Isn't that amazing?
True.
Here he's telling us the things that were of old is what is now. And those things are going to be what's in the future again. And then Ecclesiastes 1, he says, the men that come after these things always forgets the things that has passed. But yet God requires the things that are past. In other words, God repeats history over and over and over again. And this is why Satan, like I said, hates the Old Testament, because Satan knows if he can make you forget the past dealings of God, you will become easy target for him.
And deceive you in the future.
Amen.
You know, what Tayan just said, anything that sin touch or affect, it must go through the process of cleansing and purification.
Right.
So, you know, water stands for cleansing and fire stands for purifying. And that's the same thing happened to us. As he said, you must be born of the water and of the spirit. You are cleansed and you are purified, or else you cannot see the kingdom of God.
Amen. And I was just sharing with Tian off air that that's exactly what came to me when he brought up the thought when I was studying the topic today, when I was preparing Amen. For the show. Because both water and fire, God uses for judgment and also to show his grace.
Amen.
Amen.
So I'm hoping that our listeners, is that we've tried to lay this foundation, that you're understanding now why Jesus now says, as it was in one generation, so shall it be in another generation. And if you continue in that story of Luke, notice what he also did. He blended the generation of Noah with the generation of Lot. So he's trying to show you that in Lot's generation, it was the same in Noah's generation. So even Jesus himself is teaching the same thing. But it's up to the student of God or the student of prophecy. If you're studying your Bible, you will realize and you will notice these things.
And even though we might go into some of the details of the different things that was happening,
yes,
but the biggest thing that was happening was the spirit of rejection.
Amen. Mm-hmm.
The spirit of unconversion. And because only 8 souls were saved. And, you know, we know that Noah preached the gospel 120 years and only 8 souls. So imagine this, like this last days, so many people professing to be sons and daughters of Christ.
Right.
And Christ is saying this similar spirit is going to happen in the last days, where right. people will reject the truth. Now, that means some of us who are saying we are under the truth are not. We are under deception. We can be deceived. So, as you're making the point that the Old Testament is necessary, because how would we check if someone tell us about the past if we don't have anything to check it against?
Amen.
If an angel or a spirit, as Paul says, even if an angel come and speak not according to the word, you know, don't believe him. What if So, you know, sometimes some of us get dreams and visions and we think it is the Holy Spirit. What if we get a vision to tell us something about the past? How would we check it?
Yeah.
If we don't have the Old Testament, the how would we know that was there in the beginning if the Old Testament is not binding?
Exactly. But even as Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, how would we know what days of Noah if we were just going to begin with Matthew?
Amen. And, you know, to give power to what Mark just explained, we always utter Matthew chapter 8, verse 16, where Christ says, when two or three agree on something, then is a thing established. In Deuteronomy 4:9, God told Moses to pen the things down that they may be able to make tablets, that they may be able to tell their children and their grandchildren. Mm-hmm. And now we see that same thing in Habakkuk. He says, make charts to explain the past. And now that's twice. That's two different areas
and
of the Bible.
And he told Isaiah the same thing as well.
He told them to
the table.
And now watch this. Now, what my brother read earlier, when Christ says, as in the days of Noah, that's one. He's pointing you back to the past again.
Amen.
And then in John chapter 8, he said to the Pharisees, Moses wrote of me. He said, go back to the old writing. If you had studied Moses' writing, you would have expected me to come.
Exactly.
And the way that I came, because he wrote of me. So Christ always refers us back to the ways of old. Jeremiah 6:16, he tells us to go back to the old ways. He told us that with Noah. He said, go study the old ways to know the end. He said, if you want to know it's me that's coming or it's me that's here, go back to what Moses wrote and you will know. And then in Deuteronomy, he even told Moses, Deuteronomy is one of the beginning books of the Bible, but he even told Moses, write something to put them back from even this point.
Amen.
From even this point. Christ always says, go back to the first step.
To the beginning,
go back to where we failed at, and then you will learn from the mistakes. And he's telling us to reference back that we will not be surprised. A key word in the text from my brother read was that we might believe. That's the key word. I used to always read that passage and say, why would Christ say we might believe? Because Jeremiah 6:17 says, some will not go back to the old ways. Not go back to the old ways. That's why there's a might. That's why it's a might believe. So we need to go back to the old ways to know what we believe in now.
Amen.
Folks, I hope that you're hoping you're starting to see how consistent the Word of God is. And notice what Hebrews 13:8 is to even add more power to that. Jesus Christ is saying yesterday, today, and forever. Now, if you take your time and break that down, what is it saying? Jesus Christ is saying yesterday or former things or past, today, now,
present,
now, and forever, future.
In the future.
So Jesus Christ is the same in the former days, he's the same now, and he will be the same in the future. And why does the Bible keep telling us to remember this? Because God's dealing with his people are always the same. It never changes.
Never changes.
And when we understand that, it's hard for us to be deceived. This is why Satan don't want us to understand things like this.
And his standards never change.
I like that word my brother used just now, understand. Remember when Christ came to the disciples on the boat and Christ was told, asked them, how many loaves of bread they have, and they still didn't know what he was going to do. Christ turned to them and said, how do you not understand? I've been doing the same thing over, and he asked them, how do you not understand? Because they haven't been studying his movements. They haven't been studying the literal word that was before him. He's like, the same way I came to you is the same way I'm going to be when I'm with you. And when I leave you, it's going to be the same method.
Yes.
Notice, I don't want to just jump back to the Sabbath. But notice when Christ died.
Mm-hmm.
Before Christ came, they kept the Sabbath. We know that. When Christ was here, Luke 4:16 says, he kept the Sabbath with them.
Mm-hmm.
And then when Christ died, what did they do in Luke 23:24? They kept the same Sabbath.
Exactly.
So they did the same thing that Christ did before he came. They kept the Sabbath. When he came, they kept the Sabbath. And after he left, they kept the Sabbath. So that's why Christ saying, I'm not going to change.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to change. Don't try to change me. I won't change. I'm the Lord thy God. I changeth not.
You know, in Matthew 24, verse 37, it says, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. And Christ is talking about his coming in that particular text. But, you know, I just want to analyze something. We know at that time it was going to rain, and it was told to them that was going to rain. Look at us today. Many times we know the rain set up out there, we know it's going to rain, and yet still we go out without an umbrella. We go out there unprepared. Now, Christ is saying, just like when you see the rain set up to come, but you cannot tell the exact time the first drop is going to fall, he's going to be like that, and the signs will tell you. But how much of us is going to be prepared for his coming? Just like how we are unprepared, we go out without an umbrella, we go out without a raincoat, and we know it's going to rain. So, you know, Christ has given us every example here for us not to miss his coming. And he goes into details.
And this is why he pointed us back to Noah to show. And then when he pointed us back, he pointed us to their characteristics.
Amen.
That it was their characteristics that made them unprepared.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
So now we got to go back and see what their characteristics were.
Yes.
Because he says, as it was in their days, they were eating and they were drinking and giving in marriage. Now, there's nothing wrong with eating and giving in marriage, but it was the way they did it. They did it in excess. They did it excessive. They did it to the point where they didn't care about anything else. They built it. They kept. Do we see things like that today?
And also
similar characteristic traits.
And also, just to add to it, eating and drinking and giving into marriage tell you that is a time of relaxation.
Yes.
There's nothing,
nothing coming.
You know, it's okay.
I'm
you
at
know,
ease.
Yeah, yeah, we're at ease. We're going to go on like this forever.
Amen.
Yeah.
And so, would you believe a fanatic like Noah coming and talking about the end of all things is at hand? Of course not. You're at ease. So you're gonna come up against a message like that. You're gonna mock against a message like that. You're a fanatic. I don't want to hear that stuff. I'm here having a good time. You telling me that my good time is coming to an end? Man, get out of here with that stuff. But let's go see how it was in Noah's day. Genesis chapter 6, the Bible says, "And it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born unto them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. And God saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." Let us pause right here and just try to gather some stuff from here. And Heavenly Father, as we go through this once again, Lord, we ask that you would bless us and that you bring back to our remembrance the things which we have studied and help us to be clear and help us to say what you want us to say and to refrain from saying the things you do not want us to say at this time. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. And as you go through it, now you see this right here, as it was in the days of Noah. These men, the Bible says they were wicked. And there's a lot of things in here that we're not going to be able to touch on for the sake of time. But just to go over this, the sons of God, you know, in the New Testament, Jesus says the Bible, he gave us the power to become sons of God or sons of daughters. So this is talking about God's people, his people. You know, and I know some people would like to point us to Job. They're going to call us and see, you see the sons of God gathering. You got to understand, anyone that's in Christ is a son of God. That's what Job is pretty much trying to tell us. That the angels are like sons of God. They belong to God. They're rightfully his. You know, and anyone who's a Christian is rightfully God's. But in this context, it cannot be angels because we know that it's dealing with on the earth.
In the sense of as the creator,
yes.
Whatever he creates, he's the father of them, and we are the descendants in that
sense. Amen. Amen.
So now it says, and the sons of God saw the daughters of men. So right here we see that marriage is going on. That they were fair, and they took them wives of all which they chose. Notice what was going on. They started to marry who they wanted to marry. They didn't acknowledge God at all. They didn't acknowledge God in the choice of the wives that they were chosen. Are we seeing things like that today?
But also, the sons of God marrying the daughters of men. Is a fashion of unequal yoke.
Yes.
Because the daughters of men refers to like what we call Gentiles or unbelievers.
Unbelievers.
And the sons of God refers to those who were the believers. So you have a mixing of the sons of God with the daughters of men. So therefore, and it says...
Compromise.
Compromise. And he said they're going to have descendants, which is powerful man, you know, man of great stature, who have power.
Mm-hmm. And I was going to get into some of that. And now notice what verse 3 says. And the Lord said, My spirit shall not always strive with man, for that he also is flesh, yet his day shall be 120 years. And if you trace this word strive through the Bible, it's talking about like a conflict or wrestle or a wrestle. God is like saying, My spirit is not going to keep wrestling with men to repent.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to keep wrestling with them to repent. Even though they're flesh, I'm going to give them a probationary time.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to give them time to repent. And not only am I going to give them a little bit of time, I'm going to give them a long time. I'm going to give them 120 years. And an example Christ is trying to have us understand here is that time changes no one. If you don't change at the beginning, you're not going to change at the end. This is why the Bible now says today is a day of salvation.
Yes.
Now is the day of salvation.
Amen.
Not 120 years later, right now. Because if you reject the word today, you're going to reject it even more tomorrow. And you're gonna find it even harder to come back third day, to 3 days away, 4 days away, a week away, to the point where you just don't want to hear it no more.
That's a key text, bro, for those who believe the Bible is only prophetic in Daniel and Revelation. Isn't that 120 years a prophetic time? God,
exactly.
It's the exact time.
Yes.
But he gave prophetic symbols upon mm-hmm. that time, excuse me.
He said days and years.
Yeah, he gave, exactly. He gave prophetic symbols, and we know that Methuselah's name was, when he dies, it will come. So if the people were pious men and women of God, they would have been studying and understanding these things, because the Lord said he does nothing.
Unless he reveals.
Like Denise said earlier. Now, he gave them an exact account. Now, I asked myself this week a specific question. If Christ was to come down right now, or if Christ was to come to an unbeliever's person face to face right now, and told him exactly what we would tell them from Scripture, would that person believe?
Might not.
It's the same word.
We can't determine what that person believes.
I always look
but
at that.
But I guess
that
what you're
said,
saying, because it's the same word
it's
that's
the same
in
word,
Scriptures here. But I liked what you said here, because this 120 years, we tend to think that God was saying, man shall literally live. Your lifespan is literally going to be 120 years. But this 120 years, beyond that, it even means more so that God was given the generation of Noah 120 years. Noah preached for 120 years. So that was a prophetic time frame which he
gave
them.
Because this is why Peter now touches on that. Mm-hmm. And Peter tried to point people that the Bible says, notice what Peter says. And I believe it's 1 Peter chapter 3 where Peter's talking about this, and he says, Peter goes into it, and he's talking about as it was, he's talking about Noah's day.
Verse 20?
I'm trying to find a verse.
Verse 20, I think, yes.
No, it's not verse 20, it's the early chapter.
When Peter was speaking about Noah's days?
Yes, he was speaking about Noah's day. I believe it's either 1st or 2nd Peter.
Yes, 1st
okay,
Peter 3.
It's 2nd Peter chapter 3.
Second, okay.
Then he
that's
says, that ye might be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Lord and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers walking after their own lusts and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of, that by the word of God the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. But the heavens and the earth which are now by the same word are kept in store, served unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of ungodly men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing. Here Peter is saying right here in the last days, don't be ignorant of this one thing. That one day is with the Lord as 1,000 years, and as 1,000 years as one day. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness. Peter's now dealing with the long suffering of God.
Yeah.
He's dealing with this long suffering. Now he says, but is long suffering to us ward, and not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night. Notice he connected this with Noah's time. And he's trying to say that day, that 120 years that God gave them was his long suffering. He was forbearing with these people. Mm-hmm. He was giving them an abundance of time to turn from their evil ways. But we know the results. They would not.
And I'm glad you point that out, because I don't want any one of our listeners to miss the grace of God in this.
Yes.
Amen.
Because
amen.
One of the things that was attacked by the enemy is that God is not just and God is not fair. Now, in where he had 120 years to their life, God should have destroyed him.
Yes.
You know, but here he's saying, no, imagine, after you see so much sin, you know, man comes so wicked in their thoughts, and evil permeates their thoughts, and now God comes down and said, okay, I'm still going to give them 120 years to repent, you know. He's going to do that. He could have wiped man off the face of the earth.
And
he could
have done
anything.
Do
and he didn't have to do that. And that's just to show
that.
You how much grace and love to what you were saying. You were reading, oh God, extend the time. So this the God that we serve, as people who think he's a tyrant, no. He's a, this is the oh God,
the
judge
mercy,
is just
yes,
and
always
judging
mercy
and
all
grace.
That, yes.
Mm-hmm. Good evening, caller.
Hello?
Yes.
Good evening.
Yes. Yes, I'm curious. I don't know, but I heard you guys saying God don't change and nothing change. But I just want to know, I'll hang up and listen, but I want to know, now, we wasn't his people before, right?
Mm-hmm.
He was the Jews. He was, why are all of us his people right now if nothing changes? I'll hang up and listen. Just give me a little explanation.
No, I didn't get the last part. I didn't hear your question, really.
The last part where the question was actually asked. Could you repeat that part for us?
The last part is, if we were not his people before, based on they being Jews and
Gentiles and such.
We were not his people, right?
Yes, yes.
Why are all of us his people now? So I'll hang up and listen.
Okay, he's saying that we are spiritually, we are the Jews today, but we were not his people before. We would have been Gentiles then.
Well, that's easily answered.
How did we become his people?
That's easily answered because the Jews were actually supposed to witness to the Gentile, but they kept the gospel to themselves. They didn't want. If you go on the Old Testament record, there's times where the Jews actually witnessed the Gentiles and Gentiles became Jews. There's multiple stories of that.
I was just going to add something to it. Remember, the Jews from Jerusalem, they were supposed to reflect the true Jews from heavenly Jerusalem.
Right.
And that's where they're supposed to be. Even though they were physical Jews, they were pointing to that, the heavenly Jews, which is, we are called spiritual Jews in the last days, but we belong to heavenly Jerusalem. And
right. Any
one of them, and this is why, I think it's Roman, I don't remember the text, when he said those who call themselves Jews, and it goes through, who are Jew, and it tells you, definitely a one who keeps the law of God and so forth. And in Revelation 2, Jesus himself said, those who call themselves Jews, they are not. They are synagogues of Satan. Because a Jew is not one outward.
It's one inward.
It's one inward.
Amen.
So those physical Jews, if they were living the life that Christ professed for them to live, they will also be spiritual Jews just like us.
And I'm just trying to find the text. Could someone back me up? If he belonged to Christ, he are
Abraham's
seed, and he hears according to the promise. Because that goes to show that as long as we now claim Christ as our Savior, then we belong to him. So we are not biologically Abraham's seed, but through Christ's death on the cross, now we have grace. We can be a part of that salvation. The promise is the same, which goes to show. So, Carla, this is the sense in which nothing has changed, because the promise is the same, and we now have a part in inheriting that same promise. So that hasn't changed.
And also, when sin entered, it entered upon every man,
the
Jews. So every one of us was in God's sons and people.
Yes, Galatians 3, verse 29.
And you could go right in the story of Noah. There was no Jews in Noah's day.
Yes.
But God still had a people.
And the promise was the same.
And the promise was the same. Mm-hmm. And notice, when Noah was witnessing to these people, he was witnessing to everybody. Because
exactly.
God, the Jews are literally, what Christians are doing today is what Jews literally should have been doing. But they failed to walk in the light of God's word.
Because you have Hebrew. You have Israelite,
exactly.
You have Jew, and you have Christians. They are all the same God's people, but it's just different name in different period of time.
And notice when Christ first came in Matthew 10, verse 5 and 6, his commission to his disciples were go to the Jews first, and then afterwards, down the line, he says, when they shall reject, the commission is go into all the world. So Christ is giving it out to those who will receive. And back then, people knew of the Jews and who they believed in. That's why Christ said in Ezekiel 20, verse 20, you shall hallow my Sabbath, that there shall be a sign between you and I, that they will know that I am the Lord your God, that do sanctify you. And when people saw Jew, they knew that they worshiped the God that was of the five books of Moses. And so they understand that it was this God to serve. And God did signs and wonders, but people rejected them even through the signs and wonders. And now God is saying, well, look, my signs and my sign will never change.
Amen.
And in these later days now, we still have people that's rejecting him because they just don't see the wonders.
Amen.
And he said,
just the fact that God said that was a sign throughout all of their generations. And people
Exodus
tend to
31.
Think that since we're not biologically, we're not generational Jews then. But as the caller said, That hasn't changed. The sign hasn't changed, as you rightly said, Teon, because now, as that Galatians 5:3 text shows,
and plus if we start saying
spiritually the Jews.
If we start saying it changed, then we're saying God changed.
Yes.
And we just read on multiple scriptures that God says, my dealings with the people is always the same. I don't change. I'm doing whatever I did yesterday, I'm going to do it today, and I'm going to do it forever.
And you
so
want to
I,
know something?
I hope that answered the question, caller.
Something I see, it's not ironic, but it's of God. Noah's name means comfort or rest, right? Comfort or rest, right? And back then, he was the one with the comfort or rest speaking these things. And in the last days, it's going to come down to a day for comfort or rest.
Amen.
Before God destroyed the earth the first time, Noah's name meant comfort or rest, the one bearing the message. And these ones that are bearing these messages in the last days see that the message is going to come down to a day of comfort or rest. So the dealings of God is still the same.
Amen. Amen.
It's still the same.
In other words, those things, the things of the Old Testament were types. We are the real deal, the anti-types. These were types of what it will be like in the last days. That's what the Bible is trying to have us understand. Now going on back to Noah, because we push for time, press for time, we're going to look at certain things. One thing I wanted to point out in verse 4, it says, and the sons of...
Genesis 6:4.
There were giants in the earth in those days, and also after that when the sons of God came in unto the daughters of men, and they bare children to them, the same became mighty men, which were of old, men of renown. You know, a lot of people read this text and come up with all kinds of foolishness, and I've heard plenty of them. And one of the things that people try to do when they come to the Bible is they read something, and then they try to interpret just from reading one verse. You can't, according to the Bible, you can't do that. That's not how you study the Bible. How this verse does not tell me what a man of renown is. It doesn't tell me that. So I can't just use a definition that's in my dictionary today and saying a renowned man is this. That's not what my Bible says. If I want to define what a renowned man is, I need the Bible to tell me what a renowned man is.
Amen.
I don't want to put my interpretation on it. I want to put the Bible's own interpretation on it. And one of the things that I found when I was tracing this out is in Numbers 16 and verse 2. Numbers 16 verse 2. And they rose up before Moses with certain of the children of Israel, 250 princes of the assembly, famous in the congregation, men of renown. So men of renown are famous people. They're famous people of power, people in authority, people high up, people, kings, leaders, stars, movie stars, music stars, actors, players, basketball players, football players, soccer players, rappers, reggae artists, gospel artists. Famous people, men are people of influence.
Celebrity.
So in today's time, do we have people of influence? Do we see people who are famous influence the culture of the world? You know, when I was in the world, I knew of a rapper and his name was Cameron. And you know what he bragged about? He bragged about that he got the whole world wearing pink. Men. He got men wearing pink. I know the rapper named P. Diddy, how he used to brag about how he has people drinking certain kinds of champagnes or liquor or alcohol. Do we see the same influence today from men of what we would call men of renown, famous men?
But also, some of these men that you're talking about come from Christian family.
That's right.
People who profess to be sons and daughters of God.
Yes.
And pastors.
Exactly.
Elders. So deacons. And notice what happens now. Notice what verse 5 says. These famous people, what their influence did to the world. Notice what the Bible says. And God saw that the wickedness of men was great in the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What is God trying to tell us here? Number one, when you look at things today, you know, on the TV, they starting to say that video games has influenced the teens of today.
Yes.
With violence and all these things. Or, mm-hmm. or the music is influencing the minds of people today because of all the
dressing
and sexual connotations
sort of
and all these things. And because of these things, notice what the Bible says. The thoughts of their heart was evil continually.
Yes.
It was always evil because of the fruits of their doing. Now, what does that mean? Notice Proverbs 23. The thoughts of their hearts were evil continually. What happens when somebody's heart is always evil and is always evil? What about them? What does the Bible say about a person with an evil heart? That all he thinks is evil continually. Proverbs 23, verse 7, the Bible says, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. So these people were evil because that's what they thought in their hearts all day long. So that made them evil. Notice Proverbs chapter 4. And verse 23, the Bible says, Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23, the Bible says, "Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." So obviously these people weren't keeping their hearts with any kind of diligence.
And towards what my brother is saying now, let's understand when the Bible speaks of heart, it's not talking about what's in your chest.
That's right.
It's talking about your mind.
Your mind.
And, you know,
we can't think with your heart.
Yeah, your mind. Your heart doesn't tell your mind to think, but
your mind tells the heart to beat.
Amen. So we have to understand when the Bible speaks of the heart.
There's texts we can use to prove
that. Create me a clean heart and purify me. It's not like God's going to wash the heart in his chest. No, God can create him a clean mind. Yes. Let this mind be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. So we understand that the heart is actually the mind.
And now notice what Jesus does in Matthew chapter 12 when he speaks about evil people. So I hope what you're starting to see is the Bible explains itself. This is why we jump from scripture to scripture, because you cannot explain what something is in one verse, because then that becomes private interpretation. I'm telling you what it says, and I'm not allowing the Bible to tell you what it's actually trying to say for itself. So this is why, folks, if you're saying we're jumping all over the Bible, this is actually how you study a Bible.
Amen.
Scripture, the Bible actually tells you how to study the Bible. The Bible literally tells you how to study the Bible.
Line upon line,
precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. Notice how we're going somewhere to get here a little, and we're coming back and we're getting a little bit more, and we're putting the pieces together, and it starts to make sense, and we build on those pieces. Notice what Jesus says in Matthew chapter 24, and that number once again is 347-663-8638. Matthew chapter 24 and verses 34 and 35. "O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things." So these men who thought evil in their hearts continually only bought evil things.
Exactly.
Only evil things came out of their mouth. Everything they did were evil continually. Now I hope you see why God had to do what he did in that time. And notice Jesus says, as it was in that time, so shall it be in this time. How do we know that people's heart is evil continually in this time? Just turn your TV on. Pretty Little Liars. Desperate Housewives.
They have a show called Lie to Me. Jeremiah 17 verse 9 says the heart is deceitful above all things. The mind.
And desperately wicked.
To be desperate for something is to desire it with nothing, with no holds barred.
Amen.
Desperately wicked. Who can know it?
And note
that in Revelation, who does it say try the hearts and reins of every man?
That's God.
Jeremiah asks you, who can know it? But the Bible answers you and says, it's the Lord that tries the hearts and reins of every man. So only the Lord can know the heart's intentions and motives of a man. So when we see people that are judging people from intents and actions, the Bible forbids that, because God is the ultimate judge of all. He sees and knows the heart, but your heart is going to display characteristics through your actions. As my brother was reading earlier from Proverbs, how are you thinking? That's how you will be.
Mm-hmm. You know, the Bible actually in Galatians 5, it talks about not judging the works of the flesh.
Amen.
Because the works of the flesh, you cannot judge it, because people do certain works and that's not who they are.
That's right.
But he says you must judge this. And you notice he says works of the flesh, plural.
Mm-hmm.
But he says you must judge the fruit of the Spirit. That means everything must come from love.
Amen.
And anyone can know when somebody is doing something out of love or they're doing out of hate.
Amen.
And that's why God says, when he talk about do not judge your fellow man, he's not saying that you cannot pass certain judgment, but it must be judged right. It must
be righteous judgment.
You must, and the only way that is given to us for us to judge our fellow man in the sense of finding out who they are is only if it comes from the fruit of the Spirit. But the works of the flesh, God said he will do that. You can't do it. And to what Tian was saying, God can judge the works of man.
Amen.
And one of the things I'm hoping that we're seeing here is what is the fruits of our thoughts right now? Is our thoughts good or evil continually? When God looks at your heart and my heart and our heart, what does he see? Does he see evil continually? Let me ask you a question. If you're watching pornography, is your thoughts good or evil? It's evil. If you're watching a movie, that's all they're seeing is killing and drug dealing and gangbanging and cursing, and is your thoughts going to be good or evil? It's going to be evil. It can't be good. There's no way you can watch those things and not be influenced by what
you're watching. And it shows in your actions, because you were saying something about video games earlier, and studies have shown, I mean, I don't have the reference right here, but you could also check it out. Studies have shown that children who spend over a certain number of hours per day playing these video games, I mean, I've seen it with my own son, become more violent, more aggressive.
That's right.
So it shows what goes in. It helps to influence
and this
comes
is what
out.
Jesus says, what you was talking about just now, 17 verse 20, Matthew 15. Do not ye yet understand that whatsoever entereth in at the mouth goeth into the belly and is cast out into the draught? But those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from the heart, and they defile the man. For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts. Out of the heart proceed murders. Out of the heart proceeds adulteries. Out of the heart proceeds fornications. Out of the heart proceeds thefts. Out of the heart proceeds false witness. Out of the heart proceeds blasphemies. So what's the problem for men today? Our heart. This is why the psalmist says, create in me a clean heart and renew a right spirit within me.
Amen.
Because the psalmist knew the heart is the problem.
Exactly. That's
repentance. That's the problem. We need to turn to God and ask him to create in us a clean
Amen.
Heart so that we can have pure thoughts towards God.
Amen.
Well, one of the things that God also shows that, you know, he tells you to renew your mind now.
Yes.
But he also promised you a new body. He didn't promise you a new mind when he comes. He said, renew your mind now. So when he comes, that he finds you with a renewed mind. But the body, he promised you new.
Because one of the things I gather that some people think that when Paul says we shall be changed, that the character, the mind itself, God will change it. God is not going to change that. We have to perfect that. What is going to change is the body, in the sense that we shall no longer be a body that can die. We won't longer be mortal, but we will put on immortality.
And I hope that you're starting to see that why God had to destroy the earth the first time around. This is one of the reasons why he had to do it, because if your heart is continually, and notice the Bible says, they thought evil in their heart continually. Every day they woke up. And you know, the Bible says God is angry with the wicked every day. The Bible says that in the book of Psalms. He's angry with the wicked. So God was angry with these men every day that they lived. And if you go down to verse 6, God says, the Bible said, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth.
Mercy.
And it grieved him at his heart. He was sad. He was sad. He created man for his glory. And men turned the goodness of God into an accursed thing. They took all the goodness that he had made and they turned it into a cursed thing. You know, there was bloodshed in Noah's day because the Bible says they were violent. There's a lot of bloodshed in our day. And what is the fruit of that? The Bible tells you, because the heart was evil continually. Because as a man think in his heart, so is he. And that means they despised the message of Noah. They despised it.
And Jane, it's interesting that just about the same language that Moses used when he was describing what was happening in Noah's days is the same language that James used in James 5 when he's describing us today. James 5 from verse 1 to perhaps verse 6, it says, go to now, ye rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted and your garments are moth-eaten. We see that today. The economic crash of 2008, which the world still hasn't recovered from. Your gold and your silver is cankered, and the rust of them shall be a witness against you. And he shall eat your flesh as it were fire. He have heaped treasures together for the last days. Behold, the hire of the laborers who have reaped down your fields, which is of you kept back by fraud. And we see that every day through labor unions and protests and that sort of thing, worker unrest and that sort of thing, which is kept back by fraud. Cried, and the cries of them which have reaped are entered into the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth. He have lived in pleasure on the earth and have been what? Wanton. He have nourished your hearts as in the day of slaughter, just as in Noah's days, living wantonly, living in pleasure. He have condemned and killed the just, and he doth not resist you, just as in Noah's days.
So that's
exactly, the Bible puts it, even if we can't see it, as Kennard was saying earlier, he said, just turn off your TV, just step outside your door. And the Bible puts it all together for us to show us that's what today would be like.
To what Mark has said earlier, Paul actually wrote to the Philippians. In Philippians chapter 3, I'd like to read a little part for you where he says, Philippians chapter 3, beginning at verse 14, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of of God in Christ Jesus. Let us therefore, as many be perfect, be thus minded. And if anything ye be otherwise minded, God shall reveal even this unto you. Nevertheless, whereto we have already attained, let us walk by the same rule, let us mind the same thing. Brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have for an example, which my brother was saying earlier. There have been examples that went out. Verse 18 says, for many walk of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their belly, and whose glory is in their shame,
yes,
who mind earthly things. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be as fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
Yes.
Now, he's just told them in that chapter, he's coming to change
the body.
He said your mind should have already been fashioned,
exactly,
to the mind of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
For there's many that be among you that walk, but only God knows that mind.
Amen.
Because they're truly the enemies of the cross of Christ. They're truly the enemy of the gospel, of the salvation of Christ.
Amen.
And he's like, they walk among you. So he's,
yes,
like, prepare your mind now that when Christ comes, all he does is give you a body. Keep your mind off of earthly doings, earthly things. Put it on heavenly things.
And Jesus taught the same thing.
To Nicodemus?
He says, store for your treasures up in heaven.
In heaven.
Because,
amen,
where your treasure is, that's where your heart will be also. Because,
amen,
if your treasures are hurt, your heart will be right here on earth.
So it's just basically a matter of what you feed your mind with.
Amen.
And to bring it all home, to make it more practical. As Conrad was saying, when you turn on your TV, when a man can kill another man in the middle of a busy city street, and walk around with the hatchet and the blood on his hands as if there's no remorse. When a woman can kill another woman's four-year-old and behead that child and throw the body in a ditch. Things like these. When someone can look in their infant child and put a gun to that child and blow out that child's, somebody who you brought into this world. Then obviously the hearts of men
is
desperately wicked as it was in the days of Noah.
But also, you know, I wish our listeners will really check themselves on this one.
Yes.
If you profess to be a child of God, believe in his law, thou shalt not kill, thou shalt not steal, then how then you can be entertained by killing and stealing if this is the characteristic of God and you don't believe in it?
Yes.
And how could you be entertained by the things you,
amen,
don't believe in?
Amen.
Because if I don't believe in something, there's no entertainment in it.
Yes. Because personally, I used to horror films and films with murder and shooting. I used to enjoy watching those things until it got to a point where I said, but wait a minute, this is the devil's trick. This is what the devil is using to help us to think that evil and spiritualism and killing and murder is actually entertaining,
but it's not. But Denise, what happened is the closer you draw to Christ, the closer the more you study God's word, is the more those
things
you realize you don't like them more.
Amen.
So it's not like you just cut it off, because
yes,
these things are forces behind them.
Amen.
And only the word of God can separate it from.
In
them.
Other
amen.
Words, by beholding, you
become
changed into
amen.
The same image.
Amen.
But look what Christ says. By their fruits you shall know them, right?
Mm-hmm.
Now let's apply that text to Christ himself.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if we are supposed to be ambassador of Christ, they should know that we're ambassador of Christ because we are his fruit. We are his fruit.
Amen.
So they should know who we are serving because we're the fruit of Christ. We all that text such as that, when you say, all right, I can look at a church brother and look at his company or look at someone who he teaches and see how they are. When you can actually just look at Christ, and then you can look at an individual and see how they are.
Amen.
By if he claims to be a fruit of God, if Christ says my Father is the husbandman, and he's the vine, then we,
yes,
we're the fruits that he's bearing, and
yes,
if we're rotten fruit, we're far from the tree.
Amen.
So we gotta use that, apply that method to the standards of Christ and not the standards of man, because it's by our actions, our intentions, and our motives that you shall know Christ.
Amen.
And this is why the Bible can now say in Philippians 4, verses 7 and 8, and the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, Whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, think on these things. Why does Paul tell us this? Because as the man thinks in his heart, so is he. If you're going to think on good things, you can only do good things.
And
if you're
going to
think on just, you're
going to
produce the fruits of the Spirit.
Alleluia.
So the Jesus, and then I think it's Isaiah 26, it says, Jesus shall keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee.
Yes.
It's only when our mind is stayed on Christ, we will be kept in perfect peace. This is probably one of the reasons why some of us struggle with certain sins in our life, because we're feeding those sins with the things that we partake of every day. We might be watching something that sin really likes. The flesh loves that. And I'm a testimony to that. That used to be my experience.
Amen.
I used to watch certain movies and then I would wonder why I can't get rid of this sin in my life, and not realizing that I'm feeding the very thing right in front of me. So my mind can only think of what I was watching.
And listeners, I'm happy to kind of brought up that text, because I know for a fact that we all struggle with so many things. Each day is as if the struggles of life, the burdens of life, gets heavier and heavier. And our minds, especially, the devil attacks the mind and get us distracted from the real goal, which is salvation through the blood of Jesus Christ. So we'd just like to use the text to encourage us. That will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on you. Keep your mind on Christ Jesus and peace, the peace that surpasses all understanding.
I was just going to say something quick. Everything in the Bible that God or the Son of God did stemmed from love.
Amen.
And this is what it says, the fruits of the Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Praise God.
So we just want to thank you for joining us tonight. Join us next Sunday night again at 9 p.m. for Word of God Speak on 92.9 Choice FM.
Heavenly Father, once again, we'd like to thank you, Father, for the blessing you bestowed. Thank you for making us, having a capability to... It's not an easy thing to bring forward your word, but thank you for calling us, O Father.
Amen.
And for those who heard, O Father, we pray that your word was a special blessing. But we pray that this study does not end here, that they may open up the Bible for themselves and get to know you for themselves. Be with us and the listeners as well. Those that may have had questions but were too timid or scared to call in, I pray that their question may be answered with continuous study. Be with the next presenters as they come on, O Father, and bless us and keep us safe now and forever. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. Amen.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words, and the funny thing is, it's so